LCS Summer Playoffs. As you can see, though, we have entered into picks and bans. Shen, again, banned away from Brandini. And Sivir banned away from Phoenix One on red side. A lot of respect for that pick.
Yeah, first picked away by Phoenix One in the first game, so they would assume it gets picked as well. And just a lot of mid lane focus here. Champy pool definitely choked a little bit here.
Yeah, Cassiopeia and Malzahar taken away from Purion and Ninja, but Rek'Sai gets through, no ban this time, and it is first picked immediately by Seraph for Broxen. In answer, though, Phoenix One looking for some utility. They're going to opt for Ashe and Karma as their AD carry and potentially support, potentially mid lane.
True. Karma has been that flex pick here, but having that Ashe locked in, looks like it's going to be a little bit of a counter here. We're going to have the Caitlyn and the Braum. So just really fast picks right now. They're just riddling these off quick. Don't show our solo lanes just yet. And they pick up their AD carry and support. Great combo there, too.
Yeah, now Phoenix One going to take a breath, slow down a little bit. Got to reset after that previous game. They had it in the bag. They were pushing onto the Nexus turrets. They were just trying to break through that Kog'Maw line, but were unable to. So now they might be looking for a team that is more capable of taking an advantage during that mid and early game instead of being just barely a step behind Envy in overall gold throughout the course of the match. But now they have to pick their next two champions. And we'll see what they show here. Hecarim making it through.
Yeah. Hecarim, and you probably pick your mid laner here, or maybe top, if you just want to be safe. I do feel, though, that having Seraph with the ability to counterpick is always a little bit scary. Seraph has had up and down performances now. He used to be one of the best performing top laners in the entire league, and even the end of Spring Split when he was on Renegades, he looked fantastic. He was bringing that team up, and in the middle, after he started playing against Impact and Hauncer and those guys, it just ended up getting worse and worse. It was just inconsistency struck.
Mm-hmm. The worst fear of any player.
Am I bad? Am I good?
The world may never know. But Envy still got an opportunity to get themselves into playoffs. They're looking for their next two picks, saving that counter pick for Ninja and Seraph. You can see some big conversation coming out from them. And it looks like they will return to Lissandra and Swain as well.
Swain kind of out of the meta for a good bit now after receiving multiple nerfs. So we'll see how it actually works out for him. But those are both flex picks as well. They can go to both top or mid. And Envy, once again, still flexing despite Bonquish being the coach right now instead of Chart. Sorry, the other way around. Envy still flexing like always with Miracle.
Yeah.
I saw him on my screen and I was like,
yeah.
Well, it's baby Zeus.
This is the big show for Bonquish. Can he help Phoenix One with this composition? What is the final pick here? Does the Karma go mid? Does it go support?
It's up to Bonquish to put the composition together. I just want to say his name over and over. Mm-hmm.
10 seconds left on that timer. Counterpick for Purion or another support for Gate. Last second swap. Taric's glorious locks are locked in.
Gems. Gonna see the Taric now. Cosmic Radiance, so good when you have a Hecarim to actually get into that back line. He's gonna be the person that Bastion is usually on and makes the Dazzle come out from that side. So we'll see what ends up happening here, but it is a double AP composition for Envy with honestly an awkward front line. It's kind of support and then you have Swain and everybody's kind of peeling for Caitlyn and everybody's running forward. So P1, they're gonna have to peel for themselves, and I think this is such a great champion to have because it'll protect your backline while also protecting your frontline simultaneously.
Mm-hmm. Taric the Protector, protecting all of the things, hoping to protect Phoenix One's chances in this match. And turn it around and bring us to that game three as the coaches will shake hands. It's now time to get ready for this next match. Envy looking for that final spot in the playoffs, the sixth and last one, whereas Phoenix One still rising from the ashes of the first half of the split. They have only gone 0-2 twice since the halfway point of the split. Could this be the third?
It's quite possible. They've been taking games off of people left and right. Oh, still, sometimes struggle to close out the series, but yeah. It did look like that game one could have been theirs, so they have to bounce back from that.
Yeah.
They had those three inhibs down. P1 can't let that get to them if they want to keep this going and to a game three.
Yeah, certainly. We have loaded onto the Rift in Phoenix One. No strangers to bouncing back after the first half of the split.
That's basically this team, all of the team.
Exactly.
Their split, it's their games, it's their series.
It's time to show that they can do it once again. Phoenix won the bouncy balls. Trying to leap back in. As you can see, NVR rushing forward, grouped as five. Braum so strong at level one, and that is a ghost on that Hecarim. Unfortunately, they aren't quite able to rush forward too quickly and cheat around the vision.
Wow. Seraph's going to have none of that.
Yeah, come on, man.
Get back in your bush.
Who does that?
Both top laners from the previous series did.
So, trading the
Hanser and Hoomy.
Seraph is the guy who...
There will be no fun here.
He saves the frames.
He's the guy who takes Mario Party too seriously.
Oh, yeah. Who does that? It's a fun game, man. You're supposed to have a good time.
And in that new one... There's a mode where you can be Bowser and you get like six dice that you roll at the same time. That'd be Seraph.
Okay.
Anyway.
Uh-oh.
Whoa!
NB are caught making their way around. That's five members of Phoenix One. Hakuho! Flashes. And then a laugh spam. Yeah. I don't know if they still had vision for him for the laugh. I like to imagine they do.
We did, and that's what matters.
Exactly. But now that means that Phoenix One starting on that bottom side and Envy doing the same, assisting with the Gromp for Inori. And late to the top lane will be Brandini as he races up there. Seraph already on his way. And once again, standard lanes for the teams. Brandini having to go back into the exact same matchup from the previous game. He was able to turn it around by the late game, but during the early game, he was at a serious deficit.
This is definitely one of Seraph's most comfortable champions. It's one that he's actually been able to... Oh, they mark gate. Hold on.
Get the stun. Dodge it back. He's chunked down to half.
Man, this Taric is actually working out pretty okay, but Hakuho, he's a very seasoned Braum player. Able to abuse that early game in that Winter's Bite. But yeah, Seraph, also comfortable on that Lissandra. It's banned away from him all the time.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where when I see it get through, I go, okay, it seems like a little bit of a mistake to do that. Just because it gives him everything he wants. Safe lane, able to abuse and shove in, and then roam, and CC, and ways to start the fights. So, it's pretty much the champion.
He actually has, Zyrene actually has a checklist in front of him right now that he's running down.
Yeah,
and at the bottom.
I'm about to make one that's like, Dom tells another lie?
Yeah, yes. At the bottom it says all the things.
I have no check. Anyway.
Alrighty. So... Nothing too exciting happening on with these lanes. Looks like Inori is trying to secure that Scuttle Crab. Seraph did shove up his lane.
Yeah, and he gets to roam around. He gets to check things. And it's what he loves to do, because as soon as he leaves lane, the enemy top laner has to ping like crazy. Like, where is he? He's gone. And it causes pressure. And it forces the enemy top laner to continue to communicate and CS simultaneously. Sometimes you miss out on them, too.
He's missing out on CS in this top lane, though. Unless it might be Brandini as this wave gets shoved in and bounces against the turret. Now, the first Drake of the game is an Infernal Drake. We'll see if either of the teams want to push it early on.
Yeah, I think everybody wants that Infernal Drake. The perception is still around how incredibly strong it is in that mid-late game, and it's going to be that advantage that they want. Inori, though, making a trip to the top side. No board just yet for Seraph.
He's
trying to get the claw out.
Inori chases. He's got red buff ticking.
And Ghost.
200 health. 100 health. First blood.
Brandini, Ghost for the flash there was not necessary, but still. First blood goes over to Inori on the Hecarim. The assist does go over to Brandini. They might get the teleport out of Seraph as well, because he has to catch this big wave.
And, oh, the fans are split almost down the middle. 55% to 45. I think that Envy are going to take this series 2-0, but the Phoenix has risen from worse.
It's true. Their whole season has been rising from very bad situations and still able to actually come out on top so far in this game. That kill over to Inori very early on. Not
Oh, no. Oops.
Yeah, Ninja. You hate to see it happen.
You do.
Swain now has that long fusible window where after you toggle your R off, you have, I believe it's something like 10, 15 seconds where you're vulnerable and you can't actually go back into your bird form. So having a blue buff is incredibly important when you hit six because you want to stay in it as long as possible. Because here are your two options. Just a little bit of a side rant here.
Sure.
You want to change it to a bird and use it for a very long time, shove the wave up, make sure you accomplish everything if it's not a fight, and then you want to back away. Otherwise, you toggle it once and you're like, well, this sucks. I ran out of mana and I didn't push the wave or I didn't accomplish my goal and now I need to stick around while I'm vulnerable. So, sucks that he doesn't have it. And it's on a Rek'Sai, one of the worst junglers to have it. He's going to try to make the best of it.
Yeah, Proxen's chasing towards that bottom side. Was waiting in the tri-bush, but sees the tunnel get cleared out. Must suspect that it is Inori, who are now clearing out that early pink ward that he bought. And Phoenix One looking to run rampant across this game. They've got a lot of vision as Inori runs across the map.
Yeah, early stalkers. So he's able to get the slowdown and get that extra movement speed. Very good on Hecarim, but not going for the Trinity Force first build that we saw Spence Garen going for. But Proxen on the other side, he is going to go for the Tiamat first. Fantastic Rek'Sai build. Helps your clear. Allows you to deal a ton of damage early on.
Still able to clean it up that wave nice and quick with the Catalyst. As Seraph, once again, shoves out the wave, clears out a ward. Oh! Snare is going to miss. Gate just needs to be tagged one more time. Stun locks him down. Trap does not catch it.
Not quite. Just barely out of range. And Gate, he's going to be able to sustain up both himself and Mash.
Ninja will once again eat some damage from Pyrian. He actually drops bird form. This is the window you were talking about. Pyrian knows it.
Yeah, very abusable now after he toggles it on and off. It's actually 20 seconds is what it looks like here. So it's a gigantic window. It's like a real ultimate now. It's like a Maokai ultimate.
No such thing. Ultimates on my Swain? Not possible. Roxen should know that there's a ward in that bush, but heads over anyways. Actually, that was the reason he headed over to clear out that ward, as he's not going to be looking for a gank. Still no movement towards that Infernal Drake, as blue buff is going to be gifted over to Pyrian. Let's see if Inori will give it or steal it. And it is handed over.
Yeah, doesn't have a red buff like Proxen did, so no little mistake there.
Yeah. And now you can see the vision for Envy stemming across the river, actually mirrored on both sides. Pink ward and Scuttle Crab.
Yeah, allows him to have great control of that area. And now Inori has to avoid that Scuttle Crab, walk down to the bottom side of the map on a ward right now. And then there's no way for him to get over those traps that you would really want to go. But Rek'Sai on this side as well.
Yeah. There we go. The trap line.
Yeah, everybody's kind of feeling each other out right now. Like, okay, how much can I actually do right now? Is this warded? Is this not warded? And it's just a little bit of a scavenger hunt for these open areas ever since that first blood.
There we go. Inori now clearing out that ward in the Pixel Bush. Has to finish the auto attack. But he's level 6 and has got mana to burn. And so continues to look for anyone from Envy to make a mistake and step too far forward. But Envy studied from TSM's mistakes well. They are not overgreeding for anything right now. Just playing the lanes nice and safe.
Yeah, they know that they get some small advantages over time. You can see the gold went back to even despite the first blood. And now Proxen is going to look for Pyrian.
Flash knockup. Snare does not lock Pyrian down.
Yeah, but here comes the horse.
Oh, Proxen dodges forward. Is he going to be able to get out with his life? As Pyrian needs damage, the arrow goes wide. Proxen down to 120. Oh, and Inori gets the kill. Chase on the ninja. Looking for... Oh, no more.
Just barely. Ninja makes it out with 70 HP. Arrow doesn't hit either from Mash. It went across the map. Nice. Just went right through that. But yeah, Inori shows up right in time. Really well played there from the Hecarim, and it looks like he will be going for the Trinity Force first as a completed item based on what he has in his inventory. Get that Phage going before you get your Cinder Hulk. Still went for the Smite first. So it's a little bit different here. Proxen goes in. Flash, knockup. Furion gets out with the Flash, and Proxen goes for probably one more auto than he should have. Ninja gets feared away, and it's honestly really well-placed fear there from Inori, who's now just trying to track him down and get those red hits off, and almost decides not to risk it. Ooh, he was going to transform regardless. He knew Ninja was out of mana, so he wasn't going to continue to heal, and ends up not going for the kill.
Meanwhile, Brandini catching minion waves on the top side of the map. Down only about 15 CS, so doing a little bit better than the previous game.
Oh, Seraph, looking for a dive. Purion's in trouble, no flash.
Oh, the flash, ultimate, three-man dive. Teleport so slow, Purion goes down, and Envy trying to flee the scene of the crime, but Brandini will catch up. Roxanne at 200 health. Will they be able to get it though? Oh, the snare, subjugated corrupting potion are not enough.
He's so fast too.
Ash has got arrow. Is he going to go for the blind shot across? No, Proxen escapes.
Nope, you're right. He doesn't go for the blind shot at all. And Proxen gets out scot-free. Yeah, after you get the flash of the mid laner, the repeat gank, and this is why Seraph loves this champion. Look at that top wave. It's completely shoved in. So not only does he get a gank off that's successful, he ends up getting the dive on mid lane. They get a CS advantage in the top lane that's even bigger than before because he had prepped the wave appropriately right before he ended up going for the play. This is why Lissandros is a champion that's banned away from him all the time, because he knows how to manage the waves and play it in both a macro and a micro sense.
Now 12 minutes in, the teams are dead even in gold. Seems like we might be having a similar game to the last one, despite the fact that there's neither Kog'Maw nor Cassiopeia's. Both of the teams are content to take it a little bit slow and wait for those junglers, those super aggressive junglers, to make the big plays happen. Seraph communicating with Proxen. Hey, I think we can kill this Karma. Yeah. I wonder how many times he says that in a match.
We can kill this guy. It's always great, too, because it's not usually Seraph calling people to his lane. It's him going to other people's lanes. Mm-hmm. He will always try to split, as most champions, not try to bring people to him, but always try to allocate what he has to other lanes. He has teleport advantage. He almost has his ultimate back up. So he'd love to have a frozen tomb for his next gank.
Envy are now setting up some vision around that infernal break. Might be looking for some action for a kill. Nori tries to start off this blue buff.
Nori gets tagged. And Ninja's looking for the flank.
Pulling it back.
If they hold it long enough, it gives Ninja a good position.
Uh-oh, Inori, one hit away from a snare, a stun. There goes the Cosmic Radiance. But that's Purion, still with no flash. Point and click, stun. Envy pick up another kill.
You're like, where did Seraph come from? He backed from top lane and then TP's in, and he gets a great position onto Purion, who is now down a whole level, and going to be an Infernal Drake as well. It looks like it'll be picked up here from Envy.
Yeah, they collapse onto that Drake and secure it. This is the first objective for them. And it took them much longer in the first game to take these neutral objectives. If they're able to snowball this game just a little bit faster, that could do wonders for them.
Yeah, they do have to watch out, though. They lose that top turret to Brandini because of that. You don't have teleport. Well, what else are you going to do? So, picks it up. Seraph now has a bit of a wave to pick up as well, so his CS advantage will once again come back. And down bottom, it feels like they're being hyper-aggressive right now. Mash out of mana. Hakuo and Law just pushing them under turret constantly.
Furion, no, I think with his flashback, immediately aggresses as Inori ganks the mid lane. Ninja, he's buying a lot of time, but finally falls another kill to Inori.
Yeah, the Swain just incredibly gankable at all stages, even with having the Rod of Ages and having the Ravenous Clock on, they just have enough damage to take him out. Got to be careful. Got to have your flanks warded. They had them warded earlier, but it's just a Hecarim's going to run straight through, and especially with the low cooldown of Ghost, it's going to happen frequently.
Seraph might be the target.
Ooh. Still gets the damage off, though.
Yeah.
As soon as Hecarim starts leaving the ground for the E animation where it'll hit, regardless of what you do, it will always do damage. You flash away, you take an ability, a move block away, it'll always hit you at that point. I guess if he's on his or something.
Yeah.
You got me.
Knowledgeable with the champion. Demonstrating that he might be looking to carry once again. He's got a utility mid laner. He's got a utility AD carry. And he's going Triforce first.
I mean, P1's victories, a lot of them have been off of the back of the Nori. His Rek'Sai and his Rengar against TSM. And Proxen eat in.
Yeah, but Seraph catches up. Here comes Ninja. Proxen's eating a lot of damage and will fall. Envy just don't quite have enough. And Inori will stay alive. A double kill for himself. So trying to kite Ninja out. He's got a lot of mana. Blue buff was picked up. Now Pyrian kiting away from it. They're trying to burn through his health. He flashes the wall. Brandini chases, but there's the pillar. There is no escape. Three kills, Phoenix one.
And disaster strikes for Envy. They get a little too aggressive again. The three Koreans on the squad going a little too hard into the blue side of the jungle, and they get picked off one by one. They almost take out Inori. The Spirit of Dread, it heals you for all damage dealt to whoever's inside of the W range. It's not just the damage that Hecarim does. It's everybody. So he's actually getting healed here by his teammates. You see Inori. Ends up jumping in. Really well played there, too. Almost goes down and then picks up the Spirit of Dread at the very end. Gets to run away with Pyrian.
Love how he sees that Ninja's getting low and he's like, yeah. Can I get in there?
Well, he's got to block off that exit, and then Brandini a great follow here. Now, there's some questions about, you know, they haven't been playing so much with Brandini, to our knowledge. They've been playing with Zig. And Zig seemed to be performing pretty well, but this looks like Brandini just having a really good game against Envy. He wasn't too bad in the last set either. It's just the Trundle pick was a little bit questionable up against the tank stats that the enemy team had, but it was still effective during the mid game. I mean, they got triple in hit, right?
So yeah. Still leading up to about a 3,000 gold advantage for Phoenix One with those two turrets taken.
Yeah, and the Trinity Force is that big advantage that's just manifested itself for Phoenix One. Five kills onto Inori. The guy's ready to carry. He wants some Hecarim memes now.
Uh-oh. There's the Cosmic Radiance onto Phoenix One as they spot the dive incoming. Inori, six kills, seven kills. Is he looking for number eight? There goes the ultimate. He's healing. Seraph has got his flash, but Inori will not stop Brandini. Denying the triple, Proxen, ooh, races on out.
And Inori, hey, where'd he go? He went that direction. Keep going.
Keep chasing.
He has his ultimate back up here, so if he's able to actually get away to find a way into the mid lane, then he would have been able to knock him back, but that's not going to happen here. He just goes towards that bottom turret.
Yeah, Inori is tearing this game open. Phoenix One will be able to take down this bottom tier one turret, the third of the game. Three turrets to zero. And I was clearing out the minion first. I need to. We got to hold that thought while he stalls out this minion wave. He's just looking for the gold.
Hey, there we go. All right. He got it.
5,000 gold ahead.
5,000 gold lead for him. Really well played here. And Nori just going to pick up all these kills. It's like, please, sir, may I have a kill? Shut up and get on my back. Nori just running straight through the double kill. And he's 7-0-1 now after this fight. That assist, scumbag Brandini. He's off the team. Where's Zig? No. Still, Brandini ends up helping them secure it. And Inori's just going off again.
He might be trying to look for yet another kill. Proxen is trying to buy some time for Lod and Hakuho, but Inori's got his ultimate knock-up. He dodges onto Hakuho, or onto Lod. That's another kill, legendary, as he continues to chase forward. The arrow is eaten by Hakuho. Another one, 9-0-1.
Inori going off, and P1 playing around him perfectly. He is just so aggressive when he starts to get going. Oh my God, words are hard. Seraph is still pushing the top side, though, and he's playing that Seraph style of when the game isn't going his team's way, he split pushes. He doesn't TP in because it's not going to be completely beneficial. So now he's looking for these split pushes, and he's still not even going to get that turret.
Yeah, the tier two is traded over for that top tier one. Four turrets to two right now. As Ooh. Phoenix One are looking to bring us to a game three.
Yeah, and Inori, he really likes this Cloud Drake. He got buffed.
25 bonus movement speed on Hecarim.
Why not have more movement speed?
That's like 90 attack damage. That's not actually 90 attack
damage. That, it's more like 9.
Yeah. It feels like 90 as he chases forward. Oh my god, that damage!
Mother,
they just
flash paper.
The wall. Pirandini trying to chase forward. The stun is going to catch Seraph in the front. There goes the Cosmic Radiance. Another kill. 10-0-1. He's chasing onto the squishy backline and gets knocked up. Mash denies the double as Envy are running for their lives, but there is no escape.
They are getting absolutely trampled underfoot by Inori and the rest of P1. Arrow comes out. It stops the back. Stu, it almost kills Proxen. But the fantasy owners of Inori right now. 10-0-3
oh my God.
In this game. Chunks out Ninja, and Ninja is also subjugated, so he has way less stats in terms of his armor, and he just gets shredded. He does live, but he has to retreat. And then Inori just still going into the whole enemy team, has no mana, barely survives, and then Lod gets picked up. That 3-0, absolutely devastating.
Yeah, 21 minutes in. Phoenix One are in complete control of this game. Nearly 5,000 gold ahead as Blue Buff picked up by Envy and gifted over to Ninja. But Phoenix One now setting up a siege, looking for that top tier two, trying to secure some vision. Brandini will recall because he does have teleport.
Yeah, I feel as though this is the point in the game where you just go after the Baron, you know you're stronger, sweep it out, and then go.
There they go, burning down that Baron. This is a 22-minute Baron, and despite those increased early stats, Phoenix
turn.
Use it as a bait. They turn on the Hakuo, he flashes, but Inori will not be stopped. He eats a snare and is jumped down to about half health. Make that a quarter. He's eating some big hits. But he will be escorted out by his team. Mash gets an arrow onto Proxen with a bit of damage, and Inori will have the luxury of being able to heal up off of red buff.
Yep, still not going down. Deathless this game, only missed out on one kill so far. Just had such a high presence, and when there isn't a Kog'Maw that he has to just keep going to that lane,
yeah,
and he can go anywhere he wants. He can buy a BF sword third item, come on.
Oh my god. What do you even build with that?
I don't know.
Isn't it supposed to be Black Cleaver if you're doing well?
Duskblade?
And Nori. Oh my god, Duskblade Hecarim.
It gives you movement speed. Do it.
And Nori, he's putting on a show for us today.
Best in show.
Alrighty, instead he decides to finish off his Spirit Visage, get a little bit more tanky, because you know what, I came a little too close to death during that last play.
Yeah, a little too close for comfort, but it's still going to go a long ways,
yeah,
because they only have one real physical damage dealer here with Mod. Sure, the Rek'Sai as well, but he's pretty much just going to sit on the Tiamat and not have any more physical damage aside from that. So just worry about the double AP, and you're going to be fine.
Brandini now shoving in that bottom lane. He's still down about 30 CS behind Seraph, but as you identified,
he's a level up.
Seraph is having some difficulty as the wave gets shoved in. Double teleport available, and the other team's playing back towards that Baron side of the map. Phoenix One looking to bait Envy forward. Remember, Hakuho used his flash earlier.
He's got Ghost, he's got everything.
Oh,
oh the stun!
Arrow is gonna miss, but knock up by some time. Inori's looking for kill number 11. Oh no, he gets dodged over the wall.
Oh, he's looking for Lod.
His life, and now Inori will turn. Lod is slaughtered by Inori. And they're trying to catch out Proxen. He eats some slows, but walks away as they clear out the rest of the division.
Looks like it's Baron time for P1. Turn right onto it, put down another pink ward, make sure it's clear. clean so far this game, only giving up two deaths. And now Prox is going to have to go for broke.
He's got smite and flash, tunnels over the wall. Will it be up in time to make it back?
He's going to have to flat guess. He doesn't have vision of this at all.
He's on the one spot that has a ward and sees it. There's a teleport coming in. As it looks like the rest of Envy are trying to collapse. Ninja in the front along with Seraph, the fight on two fronts. That's gonna be a stun onto Ninja, but Inori is joining up into the fight. He's looking for more, an ultimate buys some time, but he turns onto Ninja. Is he going to be able to get the kill? Zhonya's buys some time as Ninja flashes back. Phoenix One will not be stopped.
This is really greedy.
There's a huge pillar. They're locked down. Pyrion gets one. That's going to be another for Brandini. And Envy are getting cleaned up by Phoenix One.
And Laude can't do a single thing. That looks like the best fight a Caitlyn could ask for with a Ruinance Hurricane and an IE. But it's still not far enough ahead. And oh, he gets gank.
Oh, the third kill of the game. That is a lot of wards in that bush. And Phoenix One getting a bit overzealous looking for that kill.
When people are chasing you down, throw down all your wards. Take these. Let me live.
It's 30 gold.
Still, Proxen, he has to flash up and diagonal to get away from this. And Ninja is zoning, but Brandini comes out. Ninja's now just trying to kite away, and Mash has the slows. Really well played here. And this, put the wards. Put them all down. Help out my teammates. Smash every button. Ninja puts the Zhonya's down. And then P1 in this choke point. This looked like it could have been awful for them. But Seraph out of mana. Nice stun as well from Gate and follow-up. And Laude just wants to... Laude wants to throw down all those traps, right? He threw down traps. He was able to get some headshots, but still not able to follow up afterwards because Inori goes for the flank. And got him.
All righty, 27 minutes into the game. It's a 6,000 gold lead, 11-0-6. He's chasing for Inori. Oh, Seraph escaped.
Oh,
no, he's going in.
He wants him so bad.
He's going in. He gets it. If Inori gets one more kill, he will have the most kills of any Hecarim in 2016.
You haven't seen my solo queue. No, and
professional
it.
Play.
Exactly. Like, he's going off, and it's absolutely crazy. He is getting a kill every 2 minutes.
He's looking for yet another Phoenix One chasing around, trying to bully down this inhib turret. And the siege continues. That's going to be the mid-tier two dropping as Phoenix One reset, fall back on their pressure to clean up some objectives. 7,000 gold ahead. This is the Phoenix One that I think fans were hoping to see.
Get it. They lose the first game so that they are ashes to rise up from. It makes perfect sense now. We lose a game to make yourselves the underdogs. It's not false hope.
Yeah.
Not quite, but still. Envy.
So.
They really want to close this out. They want to be in playoffs, but P1, they're just trying to play spoiler.
You're actually correct. There is not a single game that Phoenix O have 2-0'd. Every single match they've won have been a 2-1. They need to start off. Well, they don't need to. They certainly don't want to.
Yeah.
But every match victory they've had has started with a loss. Or at least been 2-1.
Yeah, they've never had a clean series.
Yes.
Which is why they're so fantastic to watch in the second half of the split.
Yeah.
Just they were getting games here and there before they had the full squad. And Inori, when he was sitting on the bench saying, you know, I wish I could play right now. I wish I could get in there. I could carry these games. I mean, he put his money where his mouth is.
Oh, yeah. It's now splitting the team as Brandini split pushing 4-1 for Phoenix One.
OP definitely delivered on this one. Inori's going off. They put those next kills, and right now it's Brandini splitting. He does have TP advantage over Seraph, but not for too much longer. And that's going to be the Baron start up here. You have to do it in that window where Seraph doesn't have that teleport to put pressure on them.
Weaves through, doing a lot of damage, down to 10,000 health.
You see, Seraph has to walk. He has to walk there right now. This turret on the bottom inhibitor may just go down as well as a price to even contesting the Baron. And even then, he's gonna just TP in.
Yeah, he is TPing right now. Here comes Inori. Proxim dodges the stun, but Inori will turn. Decides to go for another target. The rest of Envy are backing out, but Inori in the front eats a trap. Needs one kill to have the most kills of any Hecarim in North American professional play. In the NALCS.
Sitting here like, who's already got 12? That's already an insane. One to half. Proxen, he's blind.
Skirting around, but he's now separated from his team as Phoenix One race forward. Inori has found Hakuho. Oh, and Gate is going to get the kill. Seraph in the front, buy some time. Ninja's got the Zonyas. There goes a knock up over the wall. Inori just cannot get it. He just wants the one, but it is not being gifted. Mash finds another. Branditti will fall as Lott is actually doing a lot. There goes the ace in the hole in the period.
Oh, he wants
Inori. Oh, he doesn't get it. Oh, still not able to take that kill.
Oh, it's so close. It's so close. He's 12-0-8 now. Still only missing out on one kill. He just needs that one. He's probably not even aware of it at the moment. He just wants them kills.
He just wants the game. He wants a game three going on.
Wants to force it to a game three here. Jumps straight in through the wall. Knocks him back. Hakuo goes down to Gate on that one. Off of the Ignite. And then Gate just gets crit out as he's trying to walk towards the backline. It is so hard to see the traps in the middle of these fights because there's so much clutter on the ground. Branditti steps on one on his way out. Another one gets placed down. Inori jumps in. Lucky for him, there isn't one there yet. But also lucky for Broxen that he had 10 more HP than he actually than he did.
Now 31 and a half minutes into the game. Phoenix One are in complete control. They're not taking any big advantages that are going to help them close this match out. They need to take a Baron. They need to take an inhibitor. They need to take something instead of greeting for these kills over and over.
Yeah.
Lott is getting big.
Yeah, Lott is going to become a problem for them. But he still is somebody that they can jump on very quickly. It's mostly going to be Inori doing so, though. And he's relatively easy to stun. You'd be able to actually throw an ultimate on him as well from Seraph. He's just taking everything.
Yeah. Sitting on top of a ward right now as Tyrion shoves this wave up. Envy well aware of the Death Hecarim roaming around the map. Seraph trying to wait outside of vision.
Yeah, they found out where Proxen was because he walked straight towards Branditti and they met in that bush on the top side. So ends up just leaving Pyrian down here, who also has teleport. We haven't seen too many from Pyrian this game. And it definitely hasn't been used for pressure because he needs to stay with the team. He needs to stay with Inori in case they want to start a fight. Give him that extra speed.
Mountain Drake has spawned, and Inori already clearing it out. 33 minutes in. Pyrian gives a bit of an assist over the wall, but there's no opportunity for Envy to contest it.
It's going to be great for P1 as they try to clear the Baron and continue to bait it. Get a little bit faster.
Gotta go fast. Now the game seems to have slowed down a little bit as Envy are falling back, not taking the bait of those Baron plays. That ward actually just outside of vision of the pink. Keeping an eye on Phoenix One, ensuring that no sneaky Baron's going to be happening in this game. And Inori, despite being 12-0-8, despite being all of the kills on his team, now seems to be having a little bit of difficulty converting in those big objectives.
It's hard for him to get through anything but a fight. He really just wants to fight because he knows that's where they're going to be able to take advantages from. And they don't have the fastest Baron in the world. Sometimes you run out of mana as Hecarim while you're starting to do it, or trying to do it. You're spamming Rampage just so much. Right now, they're just trying to set up the bait. They're trying to set up the Baron. Branditti, once again, has his teleport back up. Now, Seraph does have his, so he can answer this time. But I still feel like you fish with arrows, if you're P1, you fish with Inori running up with Ghost, doing whatever you can to try and start these fights. Or you start the Baron.
Yeah, it'll be up to Envy to not let that happen. Sitting outside of vision right now. Word over the wall. Just trying to get some vision, not fall for this death. Seraph has actually gone back to the fountain and races back to catch the minion wave that Branditti is shoving in.
time and time again, but Randini not able to break this inhibitor. Wave clear for Seraph is going to prove useful here. But they have to catch that middle wave. Envy. They don't have so much breathing room. And Proxen gets hit. Arrow catches Proxen, but there's no stun follow-up. Knock up onto Inori. And he's able to walk away. Ash actually starting off the Baron. He doesn't have a tank in the front. Might be trying to bait yet another. There goes Inori. Maybe a bit of impatience. That was a large knockup.
Yeah, Pyrion like threw a Q off to the side, not entirely sure what he was aiming at, or even if maybe he was just trying to, you know, make it look like he was casting spells to the wards around, but still quite questionable because he took a lot of damage and had to run mid lane. Let's clear that wave out.
Seraph in the mid lane, now heads back toward the bottom to catch Brandini once again. Yep. Now that they see him, Phoenix One, start off the Baron.
Yeah, go back to baiting the Baron. Ash arrows almost back up from Ash, and you do it so quickly anyway. They gotta keep him out of the pit. They can't let Proxen in. Great arrow.
Baron is picked up. There goes the Cosmic Radiance, only on to Gate and Mash and Pyrion. Teleport even used by Seraph, and now cancel.
Yeah, it's Brandini's as well. Double cancel there for those top laners. And now Brandini just clearing the wave out, but they have Baron now. Much harder.
A little bit of BM from Brandini in that bottom lane as he continues to keep Seraph occupied. Phoenix One, though, now finally going to look to break down that last tier 2 turret. It's 5 turrets to 2 right now, and 36 minutes in, Phoenix One running rampant over Envy. Going to try to break this game open.
Game has been broken wide open. They just need to end this game because they're almost 12,000 gold up. They are 12,000 gold up now. It's just fractions of those hundreds. Now Proxen, I don't know what he can really do. He's seemed to kind of struggle this game. He hasn't had control of his own jungle ever since Inori picked up those first few kills. Can't fight that Hecarim.
All right, now we'll find out what he's building with that BF sword. He's completed everything else.
We will find out when he has about 2,800 gold or more.
Yeah. Whatever that final build is going to be soon. Or will it forever be a mystery? The world may never know.
Maybe the BF sword just can be a BF sword for once. It doesn't have to build in it. It can just be.
Whoa!
Seraph might not be for long, though.
Oh! Sniped again!
1-8. Seraph has just been messed up this game. They have all been coming after him. And he hasn't had the same impact. He hasn't had those TP flanks. Inori just walks by the traps.
Yeah, the trap line doesn't catch Inori. Even a little bit more BM as the inhibitor is broken. Phoenix One, 5 versus 4 with the Baron buff and a minion wave. They escort them. He doesn't even care about the turret. He's getting so many shields that he's able to buy enough time for it to fall. Arrow on the ninja. There goes the flash. Ultimate. Zhonya's buys some time, but procs in. Cosmic Radiant. Spirit steals yet another kill as the inhibitor falls. Phoenix One. Will they look to close this out, or will they look for the third? Hakuo in the front. Gate gets another one. Oh, and there's the final kill for Inori as they chase into the fountain for an ace. Phoenix One has the most kills as a Hecarim in an NALCS game in 2016, and that is what will help them take down the Nexus and bring us to Game 3.
And P1 say playoffs, Envy? Not yet. They have to earn it in Game 3. And Inori, clippity-clop, Envy gonna drop after that one.
Oh, yeah. 13-0-12 on that Hecarim. Oh my goodness.
Absolutely insane performance there. And Pyrion as well was doing such a great job of supporting the Hecarim. He did the most damage in the game. Not the Hecarim, yeah. The Karma did. The supportive Karma from Pyrion. Absolutely insane. Giving him the speed up every single time and having the poke damage, that was what helped enable Inori to have these types of performances, and that was that mid-jungle synergy again.
Exactly, and this is exactly what they did against TSM. They just had that such clean synergy between that mid and jungle. But on top of that, the performance from Phoenix One as a whole looked so much cleaner than in the first game.
Yeah, and you were able to just group up over and over again. We didn't really see Mash like pushing side waves or anything like that. So he was with the team for the majority of that game, mostly because they got so far ahead so early that he didn't have to do those things.
Yeah, they could just pressure objectives. But we are heading into game number three. We're going to review how we got here with Dash.
Thank you very much, guys. Here we all evened up. Going to game three, 1-1. Phoenix One able to strike back after a very long, belabored game one. Still a decent length to this one, but a little bit quicker than before. And I kind of want to jump right into it once again, looking at the comps selected by both of these teams and really figure out how exactly they're meant to play around each other.
I really like the Hecarim pick just overall right now in the meta. There's so many different champions that kind of accentuate his strengths. You have the Taric being able to let him just sit in the team fight forever by making him invulnerable. We see other things like Shen, Karma. There's so many picks that make the Hecarim really strong. We saw it have importance in the TSM series as well. And once again here, Nori is able to take the Hecarim and basically control the game, which is one of the best champions for your best player to play.
All right. Yeah, I mean, Nori has been hard carrying so many of these guys' wins. You know, 12-0-13 is disgusting.
Yeah, very much so. As Zyrie mentioned in the cast, if you own him for fantasy, you are very happy as an owner right now. Let's dive into it then and check out how he did get as fed as he was 15 minutes in at the blue buff. Phoenix One going to pick up a 3-0 here. And this was actually a pretty close fight just with Ninja rotating over here and his ultimate with full mana.
Yeah, and they decided to go onto Inori. And when you commit that heavily to a target and you can't actually fully burst them out, disaster is kind of the word that comes to mind. Because if you take out the Hecarim before he gets his ult off, before he gets his E or any of his spells off, this fight actually can look pretty good. But Inori is not only able to stay alive, but he's able to get his full spell rotation off, contribute a lot. And it just meant they did not have enough to kind of take out that fight.
Right, it's a hard fight for Envy to win just because they have two tanks basically in Hecarim and Trundle frontlining with a Karma behind them. So if you try and burst someone down, it's just like there's the Karma shield.
There's no good target.
Right, it's just a really hard fight for them to win, and I think they might have just been better to try and take the blue and back off. They might not have realized it was going to go that bad for them, and I think that was kind of the tipping point in the game where like Inori starting to get massive, and then that happens.
I was gonna say, so that's two kills picked up for Inori there. If that wasn't the tipping point, here's what was. 17-30, Inori's gonna pick up a triple kill in the bot lane.
Right, I mean, this starts with what looks like an Envy dive gank position, but there's a double TP coming in from behind. So once the Taric ult basically shuts down the dive, you see the rest of the team come flying in from behind, and Inori's just gonna like run rampant through this fight. Karma's job is just keep throwing shields on him and let him keep whipping those Qs around. The next thing you know, that fight's just donezo before it really even started for Envy.
Yeah, and you notice here, I mean, Karma and Hecarim were the two highest damage dealing champions in the game overall. So really putting on the carry pants there on the jungle Hecarim.
Yeah, and I mean, the fact that the Hecarim is doing as much damage as a heavy poke champion like this, when he's essentially only hitting people if he's gonna kill them, is pretty ridiculous. And Inori went off, and honestly, with how ahead he was, I was surprised it took them that long to actually close it out.
Right, you see like a 38-minute game where you're like, all right, it was probably a pretty close game, but to stomp that hard early
Look at the gold graph. Yeah. It was not a close game.
Yeah, that game should be over 20, and then you see the 30-minute mark, and then it just takes another nosedive once they finally get the Baron, but that should have been way, way earlier.
That's what I was going to say. I think, if anything, yes, it's great to have the win, but I'm still a little concerned around the fact that, as you pointed out, we have a largely substantial gold lead at 20 minutes. From there, probably should have only taken them, based on game state, who had the gold, only about 10 minutes to win the game. It took them twice that amount of time.
At the same time, to be fair to P1, this is a team that's, you know, in playoff contention, right? And, and although they are at the low end of the scale for playoffs, this is a P1 that started 0-9, and now they're beating playoff teams.
Very true.
So that's definitely something that speaks to how much they've improved in the second half, and they can be happy about
that. As well as new player in the top lane, right? Zig switched out for Brandini. Now, whether or not Brandini's necessarily playing up to par is a whole other story, but it just kind of goes along with the whole point of, look, this is a shuffled up roster, new coach, and yet they're still coming out here and challenging our sixth place team.
And I think Envy needs to adapt in the draft pretty quickly to this, just because we know that this is kind of how P1 gets their wins. They have some kind of easy engage tools here with the Ashe and the Hecarim, as well as having the Taric just throw it on your front line. Yeah. And they gave him that comp. Like, you should just be banning Hecarim all the time versus P1, I think.
Well, and that's the thing. So Inori picking up player of the game on the Hecarim, 13-0-12. The carry horse, 25 KDA, 50% of the team's kills. So that is pretty crazy in and of itself.
Yeah, I think he was just stealing kills. It wasn't really him.
Well, I mean, there actually wasn't.
Bronze thing ever. Like, you stole my kill, bro.
Yeah, I'm karma. Why didn't I get all of them? Like,
no. There is something to be said, though, for the fact that because he had all of the gold, we saw, for example, the fact that Laud was actually even in items with Mash throughout the entire game, even though there was a 10K gold deficit across the teams. So there is something to be said for gold distribution. That's neither here nor there. We've got ourselves a series. When we come back, Team Envy gets one last shot at securing playoffs against Phoenix One here today. You're watching the North American LCS.
Game one could have been theirs. They had those three inhibs down. P1 can't let that get to them if they want to keep this going and to a game three.
I'm thirsty for a win.
Envy just don't quite have enough, and Inori will stay alive, a double kill.
Oh my god, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah, right here, guys. Ooh, it's gonna miss probably.
I
didn't even look. Jesus Christ, guys, you're so good.
Phoenix One will not be stopped.
This is really greedy.
There's a huge pillar. They're locked down. Pyrion gets one. That's going to be another for Brandini. Inori has found Hakuho. Oh, and Gate is going to get the kill. Seraph in the front. Buy some time. Ninja's got the Zonyas. There goes the knockup over the wall.
P1 save playoffs, Envy? Not yet. They have to earn it in game three. And Inori, clippity-clop. Envy going to drop after that one.